Well, welcome everybody. My name is Sammy Johnson Helms, and I'm the Executive Director and Principal Clarinet of the Terre Haute Symphony Orchestra. And I'm very excited to introduce to you today one of our THSO violists, Esteban Hernández Parra. He's going to present the viola, a little bit about its anatomy, its history, and then he'll also show a few YouTube videos and do some excerpt performances. As always, as you guys have questions throughout the presentation, go ahead and enter them into the chat. And then at the end of Esteban's presentation, I will read the questions to him and he will answer. So without further ado, Esteban Hernández Parra.
Thanks so much, Sammy. Thanks everyone for being here again. I see the first question, and Carl is asking where I'm from. And that's a great question. I was just going to start with that. I am a male violist from Colombia. I love animals and music, and I love sharing music with people. So I'm so happy to be here. As I said earlier, I'm glad to see that you're healthy and you're well, as well as we can be in this situation. So I've been part of the Terre Haute Symphony Orchestra since 2019. I grew up in a very musical family. Both my parents are musicians. My mom is a music educator and a flute player, and my dad is a violist and an orchestra musician as well back in Colombia. So they really nurtured my love for both teaching and making music. There's a funny anecdote I wanted to share with you. My mom told me that when I was very little, I asked her, Mom, what is your friend's instrument? Like every time someone came to the house to visit, I would ask what instrument they played because I thought everyone in the world was a musician. So that's how immersed I was in music from very little. I started my education when I was 4 years old, playing the piano with my dad, who also plays the piano. When I was 11 years old, I started playing the viola. And a little bit later, I also studied a little bit of guitar, and I sang some popular music from Colombia, which gave me a very nice, diverse scope of the music in my country. I then went to my undergrad for viola performance in the Corpus University in Bogota. Then I was able to come here to Bloomington, where I'm right now, to study at the Indiana University Jacobs School of Music, where I got a master's degree and a performance diploma in viola. And right now I am on my third and final year of coursework of a doctoral degree in viola performance with a minor in music education. Some of my research interests are the diversity in the music repertoire and inclusion and accessibility in music and in viola learning especially. So, by the way, I just wanted to acknowledge and honor the Miami, Delaware, Potawatomi and Shawnee people on whose ancestral homelands and resources Indiana University Bloomington is built and where I am right now. Some of my current activities in the region, I am a volunteer for the Bloomington Symphony Orchestra, which is a community orchestra here in the city. I also play the Baroque viola, which I will be showing you a little bit of later, with the Bloomington Early Music Institute. I teach viola and violin for the Indiana University String Academy, which is the pre-college program. And I am also an elementary strings teacher for the Monroe County School Corporation. I enjoy singing, as I said a couple minutes ago, so I'm also a singer for the Indiana University Mariachi, Perla del Medio Oeste. So I play and sing with them sometimes around the city. I've been performing with the Terre Haute Symphony Orchestra, the Columbus, Indiana Philharmonic, and I've been doing some outreach performances in Puerto Rico the past few years, where I went with the International Chamber Orchestra of Puerto Rico. It's always nice to be able to speak in Spanish and to get back in touch with my people in Latin America. So I really enjoy those trips. Plus, it's very warm. It's not as cold this year. Okay, so I guess since quarantine, many of my students have gone online. So I've also had the chance to expand my teaching, and I have some current students who are undergraduate violinists in Kenya and some beginner violinists in the Dominican Republic as well. And then I work with some violists in Colombia all the time. So I try to be connected with as much people as I can. Let me go ahead and introduce you to my instrument. This is my sweet Freckles. I call her like that. We've been together 10 years already. And sometimes my partner gets really jealous because I spent more time with her than with, you know. So I have been playing since I was very little, and I wanted to show you a little bit of the parts of the instrument and how I related to them when I was little. So I always thought the viola had a really nice pair of lips right here where the sound comes out. The body of the instrument is kind of thicker than the violin, if you're familiar with it. It has some nice shapes in the wood. And the way the instrument works is it has four strings. They're resting on a bridge, on a wooden bridge right here. And when you either pluck them or play them with the bow, they go through the belly of the instrument, which is the top part of it, and into a sound post, which is a little stick that's inside the instrument that connects it to the back of the instrument. So the whole body of it is resonating when I play. I also wanted to mention that I've heard many times the question about the differences between viola and violin. So one of the good things of being a string teacher is that I have a violin with me. And I wanted to show you just really quick some differences between the two. So some of you may already be familiar with this, but the viola and the violin share three strings. So we have the G, D, and A strings that sound pretty much the same between the violin and the viola. But the violin has an extra higher string, which we call the E string. The viola doesn't have that, and instead we have a lower string, which we call the C string. And it gives that nice, resonant, deep tone to the instrument that I really love. Some people also relate it to the cello. I happen to also have a cello because I have some cello students in the public schools right here. So I wanted to show you the differences between these two. Oops, there we go. Here's a big cello. And here's the viola. Right here. So we have actually the same strings, the same notes. Just an octave higher on the viola. So many people ask, well, is this just a small, tiny cello? And I say, well, I wish it was, but in order for the proportion of it to be similar to a cello, the viola would have been like extremely big and almost impossible to play. So some people say the viola is like a non-perfect instrument. And sometimes, I don't know, if you're musicians, you may have heard of it. Sometimes people make really, really funny jokes about the viola and about violists. So there's some history behind this. And I wanted just to share with you the roots of the viola family. So I'm going to play a video for you. And these are some type of violas that we don't see that often anymore, but I think They relate very closely to my instrument. So as you can see, there's different sizes of them. The smallest one being almost the same size of my modern viola, but these ones are played between your legs. They're called viola da gambas because da gamba or gamba means legs in Italian. So this is one of the like close cousins of the viola. But in Italy in the 1500s, they started calling this one that we play with our arms viola da braccio. So viola off arm. That was one of the main differences between the two families. And also the amount of strings and the lack of frets on the modern ones are some of the differences. Now, a modern viola ensemble would sound a little bit different. And I want to share with you a viola quartet from the Berlin Philharmonic in Germany playing some Preludes by George Gershwin, American composer. As you can see, the sounds are very different between modern instruments, and we use some different techniques that have developed over the years. Fast forward to the 1700s, we get these very interesting pieces that made the viola had a bad reputation. So the violin started having all the spotlights, really virtuoso and beautiful melodies on top, and the viola was just in the shadow, started to be a little bit of a second-hand violin. So some of the viola jokes may come from there, from the 1700s, but also the very finest instruments that we have nowadays come from those times. So Italian makers, or luthiers as we call them, for example, Stradivari, or Gasparo da Salo, or Amati, they started making really fine instruments and kind of perfected the proportions and the shape of the viola to make it a little bit more resonant and easier to play as well. One of those violas around 1700s would have looked like this instrument I have over here. And this is my Baroque viola. So as you can see, I don't have no chin rest over here, no support in the back of my instrument. The strings are not all steel. There are some of them, they're gut, made of sheep gut. And the bow is also a little different in shape. So the Baroque viola had some really nice pieces as well. For example, German composer Telemann wrote a viola concerto. I wanted to share one of my favorite performances of this, just a little part of it, because I know we don't have that much time, but maybe I can share with you also the links to all of this at some point. Let me get the Telemann concerto right here. Okay, now I see it. All right. This is played on a Baroque viola, so the sound is a little different as well. That's a little bit of the very, very famous Telemann Viola Concerto. And the viola also had some very, very nice pieces written for orchestra, like for its part in the symphony, for example. We have the famous Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, and the second movement has a beautiful viola solo that is often required as an audition piece for many orchestras in the country and worldwide. So I wanted to share with you the role of the viola with Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. So we violists are often doubling with the cellos, as it's the case of this a little excerpt where we play in octaves with the cellos. I also wanted to share with you, fast forward to French composer Berlioz, a piece named Harold in Italy. And this one has a funny anecdote. It was initially composed for violin, but the violinist who was going to premiere the piece looked at the music and read it through, played through a little bit, and thought it was too easy for the violin. So he told the composer, you know what, you can just make a violist play this. And he decided to make it a viola piece. So, as I said, violists have a very good sense of humor, and we make fun of our own history. So one of my favorite performers nowadays, Gillette Carny, he made this really funny video of himself playing Berlioz's Harold in Italy with the Transylvanian Orchestra. And let me show you, just the beginning is hilarious how he edited this. Let me just fast forward to the part where he starts playing the piece. There's a beautiful introduction. It was originally intended for the violist to be sitting inside the orchestra while playing, but since the viola is not a very loud instrument, nowadays we perform it as a solo piece with the violist standing in front of the orchestra. that is held in Italy. And let's fast forward a little bit more until we get to one of my favorite pieces and Mr. Tchaikovsky, Piotr Ilyich Tchaikovsky, composed the Anthem of Love, Romeo and Juliet Overture. And he gave the viola the first try of the love theme between Romeo and Juliet. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a video of this one featuring the violists, but I found one where it shows how we double the English horn. So this is another role the viola plays in the orchestra, doubling with wind instruments to get different colors and textures. That's a very famous theme that comes in movies and in a lot of media as the Anthem of Love. Just to wrap up and share with you one of my favorite orchestra pieces before I play some of my instruments, I'm going to share Alberto Ginastera's, Argentinian composer, Variaciones Concertantes, which has a beautiful viola solo that I'm dreaming to play one day with an orchestra when I go out to the world and I'm not a student anymore. So this is the Ginastera Variaciones Concertantes solo for viola. As you can see, it's very wild, and it's inspired in the Argentinian farmers who had a very, very strong lifestyle and very, very hard way of interacting with the nature. So now I'd love to share with you some of my own playing. I have prepared two pieces, one of them in Baroque viola, by German composer Johann Sebastian Bach. This is originally written for cello, but we violists, since we share the same strings, we sometimes play the same repertoire as the cello does. So this is the prelude to the suite number one in G major. Baroque viola. I'm not sure if you could hear everything okay. Please give me a thumbs up if it was loud enough. I can always make my microphone a little louder. Sammy, was it okay? Or yeah? Okay, great, great. So that was part of Bach's prelude of the first suite, but I wanted to make a contrast here with a modern piece for viola. that is also inspired in a dance. This one is by a Chilean composer, Gustavo Becerra Schmidt, who was having a really, really tough time in his country around the 60s, 1960s, because of the dictatorship in Chile. So he was writing this piece as the country was in turmoil, and he ended up being exiled to Germany for his last few years. So this piece is also partita, it's inspired in a dance, but as you may be able to hear when I play it, it has some very, very painful and deep moments in which the composer seems to be telling us, please help me, we're struggling here in Chile, we need some help. This piece was written in the 1960s and I'm working on it for my final doctoral recital, which will be coming up in April. This is a work in progress, so I'll be playing only a part of it, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you. Thank you so much for listening. Tell me all your thoughts about this pieces, any questions you may have about the viola and how contrasting a role has been over the years.
Thank you so much, Esteban. I had one thought since you went from Bach to the Chilean piece. Could you hold, do you have the Baroque viola and the modern viola? Could you hold those two up? I'm just curious how those two are different. So walk us through, okay.
Baroque viola.
Okay, so no chin piece. And I knew that was kind of a big thing. So what are the big differences? I don't see a whole lot of visual differences.
Right. I also have a different tuning. So if you noticed, my Baroque viola is tuned a little lower than the modern. The A, the first string, is almost half step lower than the modern one. Here's my A on my modern viola.
Wow, yeah.
The sound also changes because it has gut strings. So
okay.
Very sensitive to the weather, to humidity. So they go out of tune really easily as well.
Okay. And it's more of a brittle sound. It's not that big, lush, warm sound from the modern viola.
Exactly. The gut strings don't have a strong projection. Also, the bow has a little bit less tension at the frog, and also is a little lighter, so it's not for projecting a big sound, but very subtle and
right. Tender. Right. Now, is there a difference in the shape of the modern bow versus the Baroque bow?
Yes, the Baroque bow, as I said, was a little lighter, but it also has a different curvature. So as you can see, this is a Baroque one. The tip is a little longer, and the shape of the bow is kind of more like this. And the modern one is actually the opposite. The shape of the bow goes inside a little bit, and the tip is not as long. The frog is a little heavier, more sturdy, for stronger and louder sounds.
Right. So Philip Kettler, one of our cellists, he also did kind of a representation. He had a Baroque, several Baroque bows actually. And he was talking about how that affects the phrasing in Baroque music and how there's a lift at the end of phrases often in Baroque music. And that's simply because of the shape of the bow. Because as you're pulling it through the string, the sound is going to automatically lift.
So exactly.
I thought that was really interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. The this part of the bow is much lighter than on a modern bow, so we have the tendency or the practice to maybe close the music a little bit sooner and give some more time to breathe in between the sections of the music.
Right. All right. Well, let me, if anybody has any questions, please continue to put them into the chat. I'm going to read them off to Esteban here. So Carl asked, and I think this, we may have just kind of been talking about this a little bit, but why is the bow not played flat along the strings as you were doing the Baroque, the Bach piece? I noticed it appears he is using the edge of the string amalgamation rather than, you know, kind of flat like you do on the modern bow. So I don't know if you could talk about the technique of Baroque playing versus modern a little bit.
Yes, of course. That's a great question. So as you can see, my Baroque bow doesn't have any type of additions here in the stick. My modern one does have a little piece of leather right here where I can let my thumb rest and kind of have a little bit of flexibility between how much type of hair I'm using to play the string. I also have a wiring right here for my first finger. So in the Baroque bow technique that I learned, I let my bow hair just rests against my thumb. So when I'm playing, I try to make it spread against the string. If I play like this, it will be a little bit harder for it to respond on the string. So when I spread my hair like this, I get a better sense of how much weight I can put on the string, if that makes sense.
Oh, that's great. Excellent. All right. Betsy Frank asks, this is her famous question that she asks for every single presentation, I think. How many instruments do you own and how much do they cost?
Oh, that's a very good question. Okay. So mine are only my modern viola and my Baroque viola. But this one actually was my first student viola when I was little. It's made by a Colombian luthier who works now in Italy. This one is made in Cremona in 2001. And this one must be around $3,000. Of course, my dad helped me buy it in pesos, so I have to do the whole translation in Colombian currency. This one was my parents' gift for my around the middle of my undergrad. And I've been playing it for 10 years, as I said. This one is more like a professional level modern instrument. And this one is around $16,000. It's also made in Italy by an Italian luthier, Michele De Lucia, in 1980. So it's a little bit older than me. But I'm very happy and grateful with my parents for their support. And being able to play this instrument is definitely a blessing. The other instruments I have around are the violin and the cello I showed you. These are rental instruments from Jacobs. Since I am a teacher at the pre-college program and I'm also a doctoral student doing research in strings, I'm able to rent some instruments to use for teaching and for research. So this violin I have is more like a student violin. It's very old, but I'm sure it's not very valuable economically, even though it helps me a lot every day with my teaching and my interactions with my kids. The cello I'm using, I think, is also an old instrument. It has some cracks and some part of it have become unglued, but it works perfectly for my purposes, which are teaching and interacting with the kids online. So those are both rental instruments from the school.
Okay. Okay. So, and they probably aren't, like you said, they're not top of the line instruments by any means. And they're specifically for students like you at IU who are working with kids and kind of in the education program. So,
exactly.
Okay. Oh, that's great. Excellent. So one question I had for you, and I think it's just mostly because I'm curious, but are there any viola jokes that you could share with us? Because I think that is on everyone's mind.
Yes, of course, of course. I love viola jokes. I mean, we love attention. Violas love attention. So as much viola jokes you can give us, that's fine. I think in among the viola community, we're very, very receptive to all these things. We know it's not meant to hurt or anything. So one of my favorite... Let me see if I can translate it because it's in Spanish. So I don't know if a lot of you are familiar with music, but we have some figures that we read in music that we call triplets. So basically there are three notes in one beat, right? If I have a beat like this, a triplet will be triple. And sometimes that's a little tricky, especially for the youngest students to understand, because we're always doing things in duple meter, right? In twos and in four and in eight. So one of the jokes goes like this. There's a violist practicing in the orchestra before the rehearsal starts. And then suddenly a violinist sneaks behind him and says, "Be careful with the triplet, it's coming up." And the violist says, where? I can't see it. Get it off me. So it implies that the violists are not familiar with these things and that we're always struggling with rhythm and stuff like that. But I don't know. The Spanish version is much more fun.
Yes. Well, I just did a quick Google search for viola jokes. You can imagine all of the things that come up.
Oh,
I thought
yes.
I'd read just a few of these. So what do you call someone who hangs around musicians? A viola player.
Oh, wow. That's a strong one.
Let's see. What's the difference between a viola and a coffin? Coffins have dead people on the inside.
Oh, wow. These
terrible.
Are strong, Sammy.
No, this is from classicfm.com. Let's see. Oh, what's the difference between a violist and a pizza? A pizza can feed a family of four.
Oh, wow. Oh, my goodness. Those are really strong, Sammy. The ones I've heard are not that.
Oh, I know. Let's see. Let's see if there's any other cute ones in here. Oh, this one's just sad. Why don't violas play hide and seek? Because nobody would look for them.
Oh, that's sad.
Oh, okay. I've heard this one before. How do you keep a violin from being stolen?
Yeah, I know that one.
You put it in a viola case.
I've heard that one before. But
yes,
look, here's one thing I wanted to share with you too. Like the cello, for example, is such a big instrument that when you have to travel by plane, when you have to take a plane, you have to pay an extra seat for your instrument, which is very expensive.
Yeah.
Now, the viola has the same strings, right? You could potentially put a cello part in the viola, and you can put your viola on the on top of the seats, the carry-on.
Oh, yes, the overhead compartment.
Overhead
yeah.
compartments,
uh-huh.
right?
Yeah.
And there's no problem with that. So it's, you know, they may joke because they're a little jealous that we have this versatility, you know?
Yes, yes. I love the excerpts that you shared, particularly like with the Tchaikovsky and whatnot, because the clarinet is often doubling what the violas do because our ranges are very similar. And I wanted to share a little bit. There's a lot of chamber music that has viola and clarinet specifically. So the Mozart Kegelstock Trio for piano, clarinet, and viola is a very popular piece that's played very often. There's also the Brooke Double Concerto and the eight pieces and there's all sorts of stuff. I mean, what is your experience with chamber music and viola?
Oh, wow. That's a great question. I've played actually some clarinet quintets. I've played the Brahms quintet and the Mozart
Beautiful.
Quintet with clarinet and string quartet. And of course, some of these are also played with two violas instead of a clarinet. I don't know if you knew that, Sammy. Some
yes.
violists play the clarinet part on the viola. So it ends up being a string quintet with two violas. But let me see, with clarinet, I don't think I've played any other pieces, but one of my favorite pieces I played in Puerto Rico last year was the Mendelssohn Octet, Felix Mendelssohn Octet.
Yes.
That's a very strong piece for eight string instruments, and it's one of those pieces that you relearn every time you play them and you keep finding new things every performance.
One of the another piece that the viola has legitimately stolen from the clarinet are the Brahms sonatas, Opus 120.
Right.
And I never compared scores, so I'm not sure how much is different between the two, but would you say those are pretty standard in your repertoire, the Brahms sonatas?
Yes, yes. It was violist William Primrose, actually, who started like advocating for these type of transcriptions, even though Brahms, I think, himself did a transcription of the sonata for viola.
I think he did. Yeah, I believe he did.
But of course, there's a lot of different interpretations. There's people who play passages in the actual register, so they go up really high on the viola. Some other people put some passages an octave lower so that they fit a little better on the viola range. I played this the second sonata in E flat for my undergrad recital, and it was one of the pieces I used to audition here at Jacob's as well. So
okay.
I'm very, very close to that piece.
Yes, yes. I feel like those pieces are, I just got the F minor, so the first one out just a couple of days ago. They're such feel good pieces, and they're pieces that, you know, I've talked about this with my professors. They're pieces that you return to year after year, and you learn something new. And I've talked to my professors who've been playing these pieces for years and years and years, and they still feel like they're learning things. And it's just so wonderful that we have such fabulous chamber music for our instrument, because, you know, there's many composers didn't write for the clarinet specifically. Like, we don't really have any solo music by Tchaikovsky, not much by Beethoven. We have a trio and maybe some duets, but, you know, nothing as significant as what Brahms wrote for the clarinet specifically. Right. But
it happens to the viola as well.
Yeah.
We only have one original piece by Beethoven, and we have Mozart. I can't think of a piece for solo viola by Mozart. Maybe there's one, I don't know of it, but that's why many performers have made arrangements and transcriptions of other pieces and even songs and leader like pieces for a vocalist transcribed into viola. So
Well, we've got a couple other questions coming in here. So does Jacob's school charge a rental fee? I don't think they do.
It's included in the fees you pay every semester. Yeah.
Right. So, yep.
But not additionally. Not at all.
Right. And I think we pay about $2,000 in fees per semester. Yeah. And that covers your library fees, your practice room, rental fees, IT, health, all these. I mean, it's extensive.
Yeah.
Okay. Bruce asks, what is your dream position after you finish your degree? Or do you have more than one dream position?
Oh, that's such a good question. I've always wanted to return to Colombia because I feel like I know my culture very well, and I feel I'm prepared to kind of integrate things I've learned here with things I grew up with. I love teaching. So one of the main reasons why I went for a doctorate is because I want to teach both at a collegiate level at university or beginning students. I love working with kids. So in Colombia, the best economically supported job for a musician is an orchestra job. That's probably one of the things I'm going for. I love playing in orchestra as well. And the good thing is you have a lot of flexibility. You only rehearse in the mornings, so you have your afternoons open for teaching, for playing chamber music, for doing projects of outreach or community engagement, whatever is your passion with the instrument as well.
Oh, that's fabulous. Well, that was the last question I had. Does anyone else have a question? If you'd like to unmute your mic and go ahead and ask, feel free to. I'll give you just a couple minutes.
I have a question for you.
Okay.
I want to know what instruments you play.
Oh, yes. Yeah. What musicians do we have in the audience today?
I see a piano. Piano, okay.
Feel free to unmute your mics if you'd like.
Does playing past instruments count?
Yes.
Of course it does.
Years ago, I played clarinet and tried to learn bassoon, but I haven't played.
Bassoon is, yeah.
And then I used to scare the cat. The cat would run under the bed. And then I did try to learn piano a little bit, but didn't keep it up.
That's wonderful. I've always wanted to play a wind instrument. My dad also plays a saxophone. And I remember just waking up to his practicing of jazz standards and the Colombian pieces on the saxophone. He's a very, very curious musician. So he picks up a new instrument every couple of years. I've been inspired by that. So I learned to play the guitar, as I said, and I played a little piano too, and I sing. So I love learning. Maybe soon after I finish my doctorate, I'll start learning a wind instrument.
Good. Okay.
I can tell you that the piano you saw in the background was with Bob McLaughlin, because I saw Mary trying to unmute. At least I think that's who I saw up there. Other people in the background, Bruce is a singer. I'm trying to think of others that I can see that are out there, and instruments that I can think of.
But piano and violin, but it was so a very long other, time ago.
You what, Connie?
Piano and violin, but it was a very, very long time ago.
There you go.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So I this is completely off the music track. I hear you got a little bit more snow in your neck of the woods than we did. How is the weather in Bloomington?
It is pretty cold, but very bright. So I always interact with my students before my lesson starts. We talk about the things they're going to do, and they were all super excited about the snow and going out and making snowmen and snow women. So maybe I'll give it a try too. It's been a while since I did play in the snow. But thanks for asking. It was really bad last night. I didn't see the plowers until very, very late. So I guess they were very busy all around the city.
You were asking about instruments, and I play the piano and the organ, and David and I both sing.
Wonderful.
My whole family, my kids and my grandkids are all heavy into music.
Oh, fabulous.
That's so great. That's one of my favorite things to do, is go back home and just play music with my dad and with my family. Some of my cousins play the guitar, and they play jazz and rock, but we just get together and jam around, and it's such a beautiful connection that we get with music.
Yes. I actually was going to share, I have several colleague Colombian clarinetists, and I think clarinet's fairly popular in Colombia. And there's been quite a few pieces of chamber music written with Colombian rhythms and traditional Colombian melodies and whatnot. And they are very fun, but they're very tricky. I have to say, Colombian rhythm is very, I mean, you really do have to get in a groove to it. And so great music, though.
right. No, there's a big African heritage from the times of slavery, unfortunately. But I guess the enriching part of that is we have a communities coming together, indigenous peoples and Afro-Colombian heritage coming together, and with the Andean region, which is another type of sound, more influenced with plucked instruments like the guitar and the tiple and the cuatro. So there's a great musical diversity in Colombia, and the rhythm is like, you have to dance to it. You have to know the dance, and then you'll understand.
Yes. Well, maybe that would be a great topic for another presentation, is Colombian music.
Oh,
that
I'd might be love a fabulous. To talk about that.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Yes, that would be amazing.
Okay.
That would be really amazing.
Well, great. Does anyone have any other questions? We have about 5 minutes left.
Do you play jazz on your viola?
That's a wonderful question. I try my best. I've always wanted to. As I said, I could hear my dad practicing jazz standards on the saxophone, and but unfortunately, in the classical training of musicians, there's not a lot of room for improvisation. I think it's changing now. There's more musicians that are becoming more versatile and more interested in jazz and other types of improvisatory music. But it was not until 3 years ago, I think, that I took my first improvisation class at the jazz department here at Jacobs. And I tried to put everything on my viola. So I started practicing blues scales and trying to get transcriptions of improvisations that I heard on YouTube. And it inspired me to write my own music. So I often just take my viola out of the case and start experimenting with sounds and trying to put together my own pieces. Trying to also, what's the word? Engage with my creativity and my identity, which sometimes after practicing, there's a lot of hours trying to get some passages the way you wanted, you kind of forget that you can also write your own music. I'm taking a jazz pedagogy course this semester, so that's one of my goals, to be able to include other types of music in teaching my little kids and other violists.
Can you give us a little sample?
Oh, well, I can try, of course. Let me get my viola, my modern one. Oh, okay. Last time in one of my group classes, we did an improv on Afro-Cuban rhythm. This was with little kids from like 6 to 9 years old. And the song we were based on was El Manicero, which is an Afro-Cuban song. We just started with some simple rhythms on the open strings. And then we started with a pattern that has the song. And then the melody goes like this. So I started asking them, okay, improvise on any open string. So they started. Just to you know, give them that tool and freedom of just play anything that you feel is coming out of your musicality. I guess I could try.
Wonderful teacher, Esteban. Those kids are so lucky to have you.
Oh, I love interacting with them. And I think that's one great thing nowadays. Pedagogy is opening up to more diverse music. And I think that can also help us be more sensitive and engaging with people who are just different than us. And sometimes that can have a greater impact, not just musically, but as a human being. So.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Esteban.
Wait, I have a question.
Oh, go ahead.
Question. Esteban, how did you get from Columbia to Bloomington?
Oh, you mean how did I audition here or physically? How did you get on a plane?
Why did you come from Columbia to Bloomington? Yes, what was your path? What made you want to end up at Bloomington, if that's where you wanted to end up for your graduate degree?
Yes, that's a great question. Actually, my viola teacher in my undergrad studied here in Philadelphia in the Curtis Institute of Music.
Now you're talking undergrad in Columbia.
Exactly, undergrad in Columbia.
Okay.
And he is very good friends with one of the teachers here at Jacobs, Steve Rodzinski. So they talked about me, and my teacher in Colombia, who is from Venezuela, told me, why don't you try an audition for Jacobs? They have, beautiful, calm city where you can concentrate. There's a big music school where you can get, in touch with a lot of different people from all around the world. And I think that was the main connection between Bloomington and Bogota.
Okay.
Yes, I'm very grateful for all my teachers and the people that I get to work with. I just learn so much every day.
Well, if I ever get to Bogota, I'll look you up.
Of course. You're welcome to come visit anytime. It's beautiful weather all year round. So
Yes.
Well, let's all move
enjoy that part of the world. I do enjoy that part of the world, but I've never been to Colombia.
Well, you're more than welcome. Anytime, just let me know.
Gracias.
Well, thank you, everybody. If you think of any other questions for Esteban, feel free to send them to Michelle, and I'd be happy to pass them on to Esteban, and I'm sure he'd be very willing to get back with you. Thank you so much, Esteban. It's been such a pleasure to have you and to learn a little bit more about the viola and the differences with the violin and the cello. So thank you very much. Let me give you guys a quick plug for our next presentations in March. On March 9th, I'm sorry, later this month, we're going to welcome Brian McAnally, who's our principal bass, on February 29th, and then February 23rd. And then in March, we just solidified our players. We're going to have our horn player, Lane Ann Spock. He's our third horn. He's going to be on March 9th. And then we're going to have our tuba player, Glenn Dimmick, be on March 23rd.
Adios.
Adios, hasta luego.